Hello. Today, I want to start looking at styling the character sheet and make it look as close to the original sheet as I can. Not that it's a necessary step, but it will make your system a lot more polished, and starting there is a good step towards understanding how to customize Foundry's appearance. There won't be a lot of Foundry-specific content in this video, but I wanted to share the process for the sake of completeness, and also to show a few tips on how I make this process as simple and as easy to maintain as possible. This is probably the point where I remind you that I'm not a web designer, so take my advice with a pinch of salt. On to the show. Step 1 is going to be ensuring that the sheet is ready for styling, which means going over the layout and making some tweaks. We will inevitably have to make further tweaks as we do the cosmetic styling, but I've got some obvious issues that I can take care of now. To begin with, the text area elements for the character concept and the melodramatic hook are resizable, and I don't want that, as this would let people mess up with the layout of the sheet. We can also see some inconsistencies in element width in the stat block. There are also clearly some margin issues, but that will be easier to see and fix when we start applying our styling. Disabling the resize of the text areas is pretty straightforward in CSS. Over in the stat block, I need to switch from the block display to flexbox so that I can stretch the stat name and stat value classes to take the whole width of the sidebar. I also need to make the dropdown stretch as well so that the arrows line up nicely. Okay, that should be enough for now. Time to make things pretty. We can always come back to make changes to the layout as necessary. There are two main concepts that help me keep things organized. The first is heavy use of variables. Taking a leaf out of DND5E's book, I've set up a config.less file where I'll store any kind of variable or function I'll be reusing all over the place. Case in point are fonts. Here's a little trick if you want to use the same fonts as the original sheet. PDFs have fonts embedded in them, so you can use Adobe Acrobat and go in edit mode to find out which font is being used where. Then you can look them up on Google and make sure the licensing terms allow you to use the fonts. You can then download them into a fonts folder in Foundry and set up the font faces in CSS. Some of the fonts are such that I will always want to have some settings applied with them, so to avoid a lot of copy-pasting, I'll put these into functions. Another set of things we're going to reuse all over the place is colors. As we can see, the original Feng Shui sheet is mostly red and white, so I'm going to define a variable for the main color and one for what I will call the accent color. We also have different sets of colors for shticks, which I've picked ahead of time. The sheet also makes heavy use of bevels, which are a bit complicated to do in CSS, so I've created a few functions to help with that, as well as some default variables, but I won't get into them. And that's about it for now. We'll come back to this file and add stuff to it as required. The other key concept that kept this process relatively painless is to separate the CSS layout rules from the cosmetic or style rules. The line is blurry and subjective, but it's something along the lines of if it's about where the element is, it's layout, if it's about what it looks like, it's cosmetic. I enact this separation quite literally by putting the style rules in a separate .less file, though you could make two sections in a single file, but this way I don't have to scroll halfway down the file. When you import your files into the main.less file, remember that CSS processes rules in the order in which it sees them-ish. More on that later, but do make sure that your style rules are imported after the layout rules, just in case you need to override some things. Okay, let's do some styling. The first thing we're going to do is set the various fonts, because at equal size, different fonts will take different amounts of space, so you don't want to carefully craft your sheet with the default font and have your fancy font completely mess up your work. The original sheet told us that the most common font is Baron Neue, so we'll set the font family to this for the whole sheet, and we'll override it wherever we want to use a different font, namely the stat values, the character info, and the shtick description. Now is a good time to set the font size and do any alignment fixes while we're at it. To keep things consistent and scalable, I'm expressing every font size relative to the base font size of the sheet using the REM units in CSS. I'm using the font size values from the PDF as reference, taking the shtick descriptions as the base size. Next, we need to undo some of the rules set by the default style. We can see that most form inputs have a background and possibly a border. I want to get rid of this to give the sheet a clean look. We also want to remove that line from H1 and H2 elements, which is nothing but a bottom border. Next, I'll work on the elements of the sidebar, starting with the archetype field. I'll change the color of the text, the color of the background, and add beveled corners. Next, the portrait needs a beveled red border. We can see from the original sheet that this same border is also used in multiple places throughout, which I've named panel border, so we can set both of these at once. Since this kind of panel has a white background, I'll change the background for the rest of the sheet as well. However, I might want to change that to a nice texture later, so I'll wrap this in a background variable in the config file so that I only have to change it in one place. Next, we'll add the background for the stat block slash weapon list combo. I should mention that I won't be trying to have the weapon section overhang the background for now. Now, I'll move on to the stat block, setting the color and background color for the stat names and stat values, adding the beveled corners on the stat value. After that, it's onto the weapons list. The weapon name and its stats are in their own bevel box, but since I gave them both the same weapon-info class, I can do both in one fell swoop. And lastly, for the sidebar, we'll set the wealth section in a similar fashion. Since the wealth title is an H2 element, like the other title section of the sheet, I can put my styling on H2 and affect a big chunk of the sheet at once. Now I just need to finish off the sidebar. We see that we have a few spacing issues, but we'll deal with them later. And now we'll look at building the shtick cards. I had removed a few things I didn't want to get into in the previous episodes, so let me put them back in. These are the icon for the shtick type, as well as a section for the shtick cost. For styling shtick cards, it's a lot of the same thing with varying colors, so we need a way to set that without writing our rules multiple times. Step one is going to wrap all those rules in a function taking two parameters that are going to be our two colors. We're just going to put one rule to get us going, and that's simply going to add the bevel box with our two colors. Now we need to call this function somewhere. The general idea is that we want to make use of data attributes to call this function with different arguments depending on the type of shtick. Because I didn't want to write almost the same thing 10 times, I looked for a clever solution that Caligo over at the League of Extraordinary Foundry VTT Developer Discord server kindly whipped up for me. I won't go into the details, but essentially we're making a for each loop going through all shtick types and using less's variable variables feature to pick the right colors based on the data attribute. Now that this is working, we can carry on styling the shtick cards. Next up is changing the title background. And this isn't working. The background is staying red for some reason. What's happening here is what we would call a specificity issue. While CSS processes rules top to bottom, it gives priority to the most specific rules. There's documentation on MDM about this, but the short version is that the more selectors your rule refers to, the higher priority it gets. As we can see, the rule on H2 we added earlier for the rest of the sheet is mentioning quite a few more selectors than the one for the shtick title. I could fix it by making this rule at least as specific, but that's not the way to go since I might want to use this outside of the character sheet. The simplest viable option for me seems to make the shtick name not be an H2, because after all it doesn't really need to be one. Instead, I'll make it a div and refer to this shtick name class instead when styling. Next, we've got to style the cost of the shtick, but we've got two problems. The first issue is that our cost is clipped in the corner by our bevel. That's because we need to increase margin and or padding in the shtick description area. So let's fix this now. And while I'm at it, I might as well fix the similar issues in the rest of the sheet, as well as those inconsistent width in the sidebar. For padding and margins, I always use relative units so that everything scales nicely if the font size changes. The second issue is that in the sheet I'm working on, none of the shticks cost both fortune and shots, the two resources you might have to spend in order to use a shtick. This is easily solved by creating a dummy shtick that has this, but it brings up a larger point. As you work on the CSS for your sheet, I highly recommend you have a set of various actors and items to see if your layout breaks under certain conditions. If you're planning on bundling a compendium with your system, now is the time to build it. The best tool for the job is the Data Toolbox module, which I linked in the description. Next, we have the gear, and this time I'll slightly deviate from the original sheet, which was hinted at by the use of tables for vehicles and armor. Most of the work is already done at this point, so it's just a matter of setting colors. The same goes for skills, and let's not forget to style this text about unskilled checks. For the marks of death, we need to replace the border with a beveled one. It's the same we used before, but with a more aggressive bevel. I also mentioned last time I'd do something prettier than inverting colors for checked marks. I'll have a diagonal line going through them when crossed, which you can see the code for here. Finally, we have the wounds section. Nothing special here. We have black text on white background over a red field with a 33% bevel. We just need to give different colors to the impairment thresholds, which have been marked with a CSS class. Sustained wound points will be marked the same way as marks of death to keep things simple, and I'll need to restrict the height of this section to force the title on two lines. And with this, the sheet is pretty much styled. Last thing I'll do is remove those item delete icons and replace them with context menus because, as I said last time, they're a bit too easy to click accidentally. I might make a few more tweaks here and there later on, but now we have a sheet that looks unique to our system, and that's pretty cool. Next time, we'll finally take a look at one of the things that really sets Foundry aside from traditional role-playing, and that is automation. See you there.